Three Filipino fishermen died after the boat was rammed by an unidentified commercial vessel in the waters of Bajo de Masinloc. Among the fatalities was the boat captain. 11 other crew members of the FB Diren survived. The incident occurred in the early hours of Monday while a fishing vessel of the Filipino crew was anchored some 85 nautical miles off Bajo de Masinloc.
Ang sabi po ng crew, nung 30 ng September, nakatali po sila sa payaw nila. Masama daw po yung panahon, alas 4:20 po ng umaga yon, magaling araw. At isang commercial vessel accidentally na natamaan po sila nung duman. All in all, meron pong 14 na crew at 11 po na survivors.
In its latest report, the Philippine Coast Guard said the Pacific Ana, a crude oil tanker registered under the flag of the Marshall Island, was in the vicinity when the incident occurred. Meanwhile, President Marcos extending his condolences to the victims and their families. He assured them government will hold those responsible for the tragedy accountable. The president also urged the public to refrain from making any speculation on who caused the incident. Bajo de Masinloc recently became the latest flashpoint in the maritime row between the Philippines and China after Beijing placed floating barriers to prevent Filipino fishermen from reaching the area. Those barriers were removed by the Philippine Coast Guard. Let's get an update now on Typhoon Jenny from ABS-CBN resident meteorologist Ariel Rojas. Ariel.
Hi, good afternoon, Carmina. Typhoon Jenny will be closest to Batanes today and will batter the province with very strong winds and intense rains all day. Wind signal number 3 is raised over northern Batanes. Signal number 2, meanwhile, is hoisted over the rest of Batanes and northern Babuyan Islands. And signal number 1 is in effect over the rest of Batanes or Babuyan Islands and the northern portions of mainland Cagayan, Apayao, and Ilocos Norte. Aside from strong winds, these areas will also experience heavy rains from a typhoon. All types of sea vessels are also not allowed to sail in these areas. Jenny was located 210 kilometers northeast of Itbayat, Batanes, with maximum winds of 150 kilometers per hour and gusts up to 185 kilometers per hour. It is presently moving west-northwestward at 15 kilometers per hour. Some other areas in northern Luzon will also experience scattered rains from the typhoon. The southwest monsoon or Habagat, enhanced by Jenny, is also bringing rains over Bataan, Occidental Mindoro, and Calamian Islands in northern Palawan. Later, there will also be intense thunderstorms over other parts of central Luzon, northern Mindanao, and Caraga. Jenny is forecast to make landfall over southern Taiwan tomorrow morning and will be out of the Philippine area of responsibility in the afternoon or evening. It will continue to bring rains over extreme northern Luzon, and its enhanced Habagat will affect the western section of Luzon, especially northern and central Luzon, until Friday. And here in Metro Manila, the skies will be overcast throughout the day with scattered rains expected later. Gloomy conditions will persist until Friday.
Batanes and Cagayan feeling the wrath of Typhoon Jenny. Our very own Harris Hulu now joins us with the latest. Harris, what more can you tell us?
Carmina, the impact of Typhoon Jenny is felt in the province of Batanes. According to Governor Marilu Caico, strong winds and at times heavy rain are prevailing. She mentioned that they are still in relatively good condition. In a video shared by Vince Gabilo, the town of Sabtang is experiencing torrential rain. The waves are also strong at Sabtang Port. The Batanes have prepared for the possible effects of the typhoon. As customary, they tied the roofs of their houses, schools, and other establishments. They also installed tapanco or covers for windows. The police assisted in their preparations. Classes are still suspended in all levels of schools throughout the province. Meanwhile, harsh weather is also being experienced in Calayan, Cagayan. In a video shared by Barangay Kagawa Jeyo Arirao, large waves are crashing on the shores. The strong wind and heavy rain also evident. There have been no reports of residents evacuating yet. However, the Provincial Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Office advises extra preparation and caution, especially for those living in low-lying and landslide-prone areas.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. lifts the controversial price cap on rice. This as he acknowledges rising prices of agricultural products contributed to the double-digit drop in his approval rating. Our very own Katrina Domingo now joins us with more on this. Kat, over to you.
Hi, Carmina, just as you mentioned, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. has already lifted the price cap that he earlier imposed on several varieties of rice, saying that the supply of the staple grain in the country is already more stable, considering that the buffer stock of rice in the country already stands at 30 days. And with the advent of the harvest season, the president expects that number to further increase to up to 70 days worth of buffer stock. Now, Carmina, while the lifting of the price cap on rice takes effect today, the president underscores that rice aid programs for farmers and poor families will still continue. Now, among these programs are the distribution of rice that were seized in ports to beneficiaries of the Pantawid Pamilya program, as well as the procurement of agricultural machineries for farmers and fisherfolk. The president says the House of Representatives has also agreed to come up with a program wherein the 33 congressional representatives of Metro Manila will facilitate a separate distribution of rice aid to their constituents. That's because the price of rice in Metro Manila continues to be higher, or the rice continues to be more expensive in the capital region compared to other areas in the Philippines. Marcos Jr. says these efforts are done to pull down the prices of the staple grain and not to remedy the double-digit drop in his recent approval ratings. If we recall, Pulse Asia earlier said that the 15 percentage point plunge in Marcos Jr.'s approval numbers is most likely due to the high prices of rice and other basic commodities. Let's take a listen.
It's not surprising. People are having a hard time. Ibang usapan pag bigas. It's different from anything else that any other agricultural product. I completely understand it. And that's why we're working very, very hard to make sure that this comes up again. Not because of the survey. That's not important to me. What's important to me is that we make sure that people have enough to eat and that it is affordable to them. Hindi mo masisi ang tao. Talagang naghihirap sila eh.
Meantime, Carmina, the government has also filed cases against at least four rice trading companies that were accused of hoarding rice in parts of Bulacan to allegedly manipulate market prices. The president also warning other players who plan to make profit at the expense of the Philippine economy. Carmina.
Thanks a lot. Katrina Domingo there joining us live. A commuters group pressing government to suspend the excise tax on fuel amid the 1 peso fare increase for public utility jeepneys. Beginning October 8th, the minimum fare for traditional jeepneys will be 13 pesos, while modern jeepney passengers need to pay at least 15 pesos. For the group passenger forum, government's removal of the fuel excise tax will prevent fare hikes. Finance Secretary Benjamin Diokno had opposed the idea, saying government would lose billions in revenue. News.
Ang sa amin, mahalaga na napigilan yung 5 piso, pero nagkaroon din po ng commitment yung ating mga chopper at operator na once maging 56 to 57 po yung per liter ng krudo, ay tatanggalin din ito agad. Ang sa amin, kung ayaw nilang isuspinde, kailangan magkaroon ng maayos na programa na tungkol sa fuel subsidy, yung epektibo, no? Yung tututok po talaga doon sa apektado ng pagtaas ng krudo para mapigilan yung pagtaas ng pamasahe.
The Philippine Labor Department admits companies still prefer hiring those who finished college compared to K-12 graduates. And even if they get hired, Labor Secretary Bienvenido Laguesma says K-12 graduates are only accepted for low-level positions with low pay. Laguesma's remarks come after a recent survey showed at least 50% of Filipinos were dissatisfied with the program.